Hallelujah. Praise be to God. Okay. And then the other thing, I want to challenge you men for morning prayer. You need to come out for morning prayer. I mean, after this great time we had with Pastor Chilindi, there's so much in that revival, you know. How much more do you want me to command you to do things? You need to come out for morning prayer. This is not some kind of, you know, I was telling Pastor Chilindi how this, because he was talking about in a sense of commanding, and I said, well, there is this person who actually said that the 10 commandments should have been 10 suggestions. You know, I mean, as I was telling the whole story, it's a far deeper story, okay? And so he was saying, oh my goodness, I wish I'd known this before I preach. I said, okay, next time you preach, you can edit your message. But these are not suggestions. I'm not making some suggestions here. You need to come out and join us here at church for morning prayer. That's how we defeat spiritual dynamics. And take time again and listen to this morning's message, please. Do that, and that's going to be very helpful to you. And so we are raging spiritual warfare, and that becomes very, very important. All right, so tonight we have special ministry. Okay. And this is from young men who they want to do God's will in their hearts. Some of these want to be preachers. And God is developing them, bringing them up for such times as this. And what is going to happen? Obviously, they will have 15 minutes or less, each one, to minister. And the sound man in the back will keep time. As long as the first person come here, you are timing it. I don't want no distraction from you. Oh, I forgot. There's nothing forgotten. That's your task to do. And so you have to keep time. And when it's 3 minutes before the time, you need to show them that some kind of a flush that, hey, your time is almost done. If they don't have their own time here, I told them to have their own time anyway. Okay, so that's how we're going to do it. And that is from the first to the third. Okay, and so they need to know that, hey, I'm out of time. And I need to end here. All right, so they're going to come in this order. So it's going to be Kalangere, it's going to be Benjipa, and then we're going to have Maduva. Let's welcome these young men as they come to minister.
Amen. Amen. Yo. Good evening, church. You know, I just want to take time, thank Pastor for the challenge. Let's get into it, man. My timer. My sermon, my message title is Exposing the Devil. Before we get into that, let's pray, man. Thank you, Heavenly Father God, for this privilege. I pray, Lord God, that you would help us, God. Help us to hear your voice. I pray, Lord God, that you would hide my flesh behind the cross. Use me, God, as an earpiece, Lord God. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. All right, so Yeah, without further ado. So my text is John 8:44. All right, so yeah, we are exposing the devil tonight. All right, let's read. You are of your father the devil, and the desires of your father you want to do. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own resources, for he is a liar and the father of it. Yeah? All right, so I want you guys to, okay, so check. There was a story of three boys, right? So they would walk home from school, you know, and they would take a certain route. And in this route, there was a house with a very big and scary dog, ugly dog. So whenever they would pass by the street, you know, the dog would bark at them, you know, and then they would be scared, of course. It's a big and ugly, scary dog. So, but the thing is, the dog couldn't reach them because it was chained. So every time they would make sure they are like far away from that yard. They walk the other side of the road, basically, you know, until one day the owner of the dog noticed that, oh no, these boys are afraid of my dog, you know, they're always trying to go that side. I mean, but then, and then he was like, okay, the next time he called them and he was like, okay guys, I noticed you guys are afraid of my dog, but let me show you guys something. And then he opened the dog's mouth. Turns out the dog didn't have any teeth, like at all. So, and then he was like, there's no need to be afraid of this dog, you know, because it doesn't have teeth. Even if it gets to you, it cannot harm you whatsoever. You see, that dog is the devil. Okay? You know, the devil may look scary, may look, you know, intimidating, but my friend, the devil is already been defeated. You know, he's this dog I was talking about. You know, I don't know what the scariest dog is for you. Maybe it's a pit bull, Rottweiler, bulldog. I don't know what it is for you. You know, that whatever that dog is, that is the devil, but without teeth. You know, all he can do is just bark at you, scare you, you know, intimidate you into conforming to his ways, basically. You know, he can't harm you because he doesn't have teeth. You know what I'm saying? You know, from the distance, I mean, I know if I'm walking in this direction, there's that ugly dog there, it's barking at me. Hey, from there, I'll be like, I'm not going that way, I'm going the other way. Because the dog looks scary, but that's just from a distance. You need to get up close, okay? You need to confront this dog, you know? You need to confront the devil. See, you need to confront him, because all he does is just, you know, intimidate you and scare you. You see, the thing is, the amount of damage the devil can cause towards you is the amount of damage that you allow him to cause. Because like I said, he cannot come bite you or whatever. He can just scare you into conforming to his ways. He can just scare you into fornication, or he can scare you into, you know, doing drugs or whatever, because you feel like, I need to fit in, eh? If I don't do this, I won't fit in, what? That's all he can do, you know? Because the thing is, you know, When your mind, you know, when your mind is made up, it's not that the devil will stop trying to bark at you, or will stop trying to intimidate you or whatnot. See, when your mind is made up, you know, the devil appears like a chihuahua. You know, he's like, man, you're bothering me. Get out of my way. You know, I want to live for God. You get what I mean? So, you see, you just want to entertain him. You know, therefore he can't scare you into like conforming to him. See, let's talk about how to not be affected by the devil when he's trying to bark at you. see how you can equip yourself to handle the devil's barking. Get to know God and submit to God. You know, because when you know God, you know His promises for you. You know what I'm saying? You know, promises to fight for you. See, like what it says in Exodus 14:14. Let me quickly get there. See, it says, "The Lord will fight for you, and you shall hold your peace." Like it says in Isaiah 41:10. See, it says, "Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." And then Isaiah 41:13. "For I, the Lord your God, will hold your right hand, saying to you, fear not, I will help you." Isaiah 54:17. "No weapon formed against you shall prosper, and every tongue which rises against you in judgment, you shall condemn. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their righteousness is from me, says the Lord." And then another way as well of, you know, I guess equipping yourself to deal with the devil's barking is, you should know the devil, okay? Know him, because when you know your enemy, you know his strategies. You know what he intends. You know what he, how he operates, you get? Let's read John 10:10. "The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly." See, that's the enemy, that's the devil, you know. And the way to get to know the devil, you know, is through reading your Bible. It's through coming to church, you know, hearing the word of God, you know. It's through prayer as well. You get what I mean? Talk to God about this. "God, show me his ways. Show me his strategies so I can avoid them." Talk to God. Pray. And the same, if you how to know God, read your Bible. Come to church. Pray. Ask God, "God, who are you?" See, when you don't know God for who he truly is, when you don't know who he is in your life, you're vulnerable to the devil's intimidation. That's why you need to equip yourself. You know what I'm saying? Therefore, let's read James 4:7-8. "Therefore, submit to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded." You see, draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. See, when you don't know God, you know, you're vulnerable. You know, when you're out of God, you're out of your natural habitat. See, like a fish in the water. When you take it out, it dies. That's you. Okay, if you remove yourself, or if you allow yourself to be removed from the will of God, you will die. So, you know, hey, get back to your natural habitat. That's how you can, you know, be equipped, you know, to handle the devil when he, I guess, visits. So yeah, thanks. That's all I had.
1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2. Okay, I just want to say thank you to Pastor, first of all, for the opportunity. It's such a huge privilege. Thank you so much, Pastor. And also thank you to my brother, Kavangere. So, I want to talk to you guys on a simple topic that I have simply entitled, Don't Sell Your Inheritance. So this sermon came about when I was, I went to go and visit some few boys that were in church, and I believe this was 3 months ago when Pastor Greg came for the rally, and we were visiting these boys and checking up on them, and many of them were not doing so well. Now, many of them were struggling, many of them were, you know, were going through all the emotions, and simply what happened to me is that, you know what, something came to my mind, and the Spirit of God just whispered and said, you know what, Ben Chipa, inheritance have been lost. That, you know, the thing is that the believer's inheritance is described more specifically as internal and joyful existence with God, right? That's our inheritance, is to spend time or to spend eternity with God, is to have this unending fellowship in the kingdom of God. That's our inheritance. Our inheritance is simply the kingdom of God, which is heaven. So inheritance, the word inheriting the world to come is a guarantee for all those who belong to God's family. That's you and I. The moment you and I gave our lives to God, what happened is that we became part of the inheritance of God. We became heirs with Jesus Christ. That's what the Bible says. So in 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 4, let me just get there quickly. 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 4. We'll read our scripture in a while quickly. So it speaks and it says, it reads and says, 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 4. To an inheritance that is, blessed be the God of our Father. Let me start from verse 3. Blessed be the God of our Father, our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is not perishable, that is not defiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you and me. That's what the Bible says. So in our text, it comes from the book of Luke chapter 1, the book of Luke chapter 15, starting from verse 11, reads and says quickly, Luke 15, 11. And he said, there was a man who had two sons. The younger of them said to the father, Father, give me the share of property that belongs to him. Or in other words, give me my inheritance. And he divided his property between them. And not many days later, the younger son gathered all that he had and took a journey into a far country. And there he squandered his property in reckless living. And when he had spent everything, a severe famine arose in the country, and he began to be in need. Let's pray. Father, we thank you, God, for what you're going to do, God. This evening we pray that you'd have right of way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we understood that, you know what, that we have an inheritance. That you and I, my friend, that our inheritance is the kingdom of God. And this is going to happen, that one day the Bible says that, you know what, that the Son of Man is going to come in a cloud, and all God's people are going to be taken up, and we are all going to have internal peace or internal joy with the Lord. But then the Bible says, when you gave your life to Jesus, you became an heir to God, and you have all the privileges of the Son. This is found in the book of Titus chapter 3 verse 5 to verse to verse 17, as well in the book of Galatians chapter 4 verse 7. Our inheritance is described as unperishable, right? It is described as unspoiled, and it does not fade away. How many knows that that's something that God can only offer? That's nothing that the world can offer. A world, you know, this world contains of things that are, you know, that everything that the world has to offer you is spoiled and fades away. The joy of this world doesn't last. But my friend, the Bible says that you know that the Bible that our inheritance that God has offered you and I is unspoilable and it's unperishable and it doesn't fade away. This is nothing that the world can offer you. Meaning it's nothing that the world can, or that the world could ever offer you. It has to be from God. In our text, the younger son understood that I'm a son, so there must be something for me. So he knows that what my father has is also mine, right? This is what we do. You know that, you know that I'm benefiting in everything that belongs to my father. He knows that what my father has is going to be mine. In verse 12, he's already expecting something to happen. He said, you know what, give me my portion of your inheritance. You know, sometimes we also do that. Sometimes we come to God. God, you know what? I don't want to live this way anymore. Can you just give me my inheritance right now? Let me go and enjoy life as I want to enjoy. Let me go out there and live in this sinful life that I'm living. I want to run after the girls. I want to run after the alcohol. I want to live life like this. But how many of us know that, you know what? That our inheritance in the Lord is way better than the inheritance of this world. Just like him, we too have that mindset that, you know, that God has promised us something. This is found in the book of John, chapter 14, verse 2 to verse 6, where he says that, where Jesus is telling them that he's going to go and prepare a place for you and I, and he's going to come and give us one of the rooms there in heaven. Our inheritance in this case is the kingdom of God, and it's spending eternity with God. It's living life without fears, no hurts, no pain, and no suffering. Revelation 21 verse 4 describes this, and as well as 1 Corinthians chapter 9 1 Corinthians chapter 2 verse 9. It reads and says, but just as it is written in Scripture, these things which the eye has not seen and the ear has not heard and which have not entered the heart of man, all that God has prepared for those who love him and who hold in affection reverence, who by him who gratefully recognize the benefits that he has bestowed unto us. My friend, the Bible here says that, you know what, that our inheritance that we have is way better than all the other things. It says that, you know what, that eye has not heard, no, the eye have not seen, no ear have ever heard what God has in store for you. It says that, you know what, that this have never occurred into the heart of man, what God has in store for you. So it means that our inheritance is incomparable to anything in this world. We know the benefit that comes with living in the presence of God. Many of us know this, that when we are with God, that we become more than conquerors. We know that we don't struggle from things like the world are struggling. We know that we have grace, we have favor as children of God. But how many of us know that, this is my second point, how many of us know that there is a temptation to sell the inheritance? So what happened is that despite all these promises of eternal life, of heaven and everlasting peace, there is still a temptation to sell the inheritance. There is still this one thing that compels us to turn away from God and forsake heaven and forsake the heavenly goal that is set before us. We know sometimes we sit there and we count, I know, is this thing called being a believer worth it at this point? Is this thing of heaven truly something that I need to do? My friend, you know, you and I have an enemy. And sin can blind you and you won't consider your inheritance anymore. You know, this boy is probably thinking of all these things that are happening around him. The influence that is going on probably in the streets. Maybe many of his peers are out there. They are drinking alcohol. Or probably they are out there. They are enjoying the benefits of this world. And he's looking at it like, you know what? I'm missing out, man. I want to live life like all the other people are living. He's looking at his life and you know, I'm tired of being a homie. I'm tired of being a homeboy or being a mommy's boy, being kept at home and just come to service, being forced every day to come to service. But you know, this boy is considering all these things and he's like, you know what, man, this inheritance can just go. I can go right now and enjoy myself at this point. He's probably looking through the window and sees all the latest things that the world is trending on right now. He's probably looking at all the wealth that the world is portraying at this point. He looked at his life and probably said, you know what, I'm missing out. How many of us, you know, believers at this point, you know, we also go through such things. Older believers, younger believers, sometimes you look at your life and, oh, should I continue in such situations where I'm going to keep my dignity as somebody that God has called? Or should I go out there and squander everything? We can be safe for a long time and still struggle with reality. It doesn't mean that you are in church and everything is okay. No, my friend, we all go through serious battles. And sometimes a question is raised about our inheritance. Sometimes we are there considering, you know, should I continue, you know, in this work of this Christian life? Should I continue, you know, being faithful? Should I continue in ministry? Should I continue performing this task? Every day you ask yourself, should I continue living in this way? Can I not just sell my inheritance and just go like the world and enjoy the benefits of the world? Others, you know, couples in this place are like, you know what, should I continue with this person that I've been married with for all this time, or should I just go and venture elsewhere? My friend, there is a serious temptation into selling our inheritance. You know, many people walk away from God after 20 years, after 15 years. But still, you know, that it tells you that, you know, that it, you know, there is a serious temptation in selling our inheritance. Satan doesn't play fair, and we all know this. But still, we have to hold on to the truth that, you know what, that our inheritance, my friend, is promised with God. You know, that our inheritance, my friend, is life beyond this world could ever offer, my friend. Our inheritance, my friend, is internal peace and joy in the presence of God. You know, Esau sold his birthright just like that. In Genesis 25, starting from verse 29 to verse 34, you know, just because of a meal, he decided that, you know what, no, let it go. Reckless living will cost you your inheritance. You can't afford to take, you can't afford to wake up, you can't afford to walk out of your father's house with all the benefits that it holds, my friend. There's so much benefits being in the house of God. There's so much peace. There's so much happiness in being in this place. But other people, they don't consider that, my friend. Other people, they're like, no, man, what is the need of being faithful? What is the need of me being faithful to one church, being faithful to one honor, to all of these things? Many of us want to go and leave our inheritance and just sell it away to the first side that comes. Heaven is the goal, beloved, and heaven is the destination. We all have to live in this way, saying that, you know what, my friend, as long as I'm on earth, I'm going to keep my inheritance. As long as I'm born again, I'm going to fight for my relationship with Jesus Christ, no matter what, my friend. You know, Mark 8, verse 36, the Bible says, what will it profit a man if he gains his whole world and loses his own soul? We all are familiar with this scripture. But how many of us know that the reality of it is deep? That, you know what, the world can offer us very nice, shiny things. But the question is, will you hold on to your inheritance? You know, people fall up, they fall prey to all these latest things that goes on. You know, this other day I was listening to Pastor Marty Kaniki. He was giving all the stats on pornography and all these things, my friend. And scary sights were mentioned at that point. But you know, believers sometimes also do this. Believers sometimes they go through all these things and they forget about their inheritance. Heaven is the honor. Heaven is its home, and heaven is it's the destination. And the book of Proverbs 20 verse 21, it says, do not sell your birthright. Do not sell your birthright. Do not give it away cheaply. Or it says, do not sell it at first sight, because at the end it's not going to be blessed. I'm going to leave you with this and say, come back home, beloved.
Two. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much for the warm welcome. Uncle Pius was wondering if it's hot up here. It's actually burning up here. And strangely enough, I don't know why my heart is beating fast, man. Check, it's one thing to do a special song. It's another one to preach a message. You know, there have been many men who have stood behind you that I have great respect for. So I just want to thank all of you. Please pray for me in your seats. And amen. We'll get straight into it. Amen. So my text for tonight is Proverbs 14, verse 4. I also like to thank Avax and Benjipa. You ease the burden a bit. And for the first time, actually, I feel like a last born. So thank you so much, guys. Thank you so much, guys. All right. So Proverbs, my main text is Proverbs 14, verse 4. So my title is The Messy Harvest. So the Bible says, Proverbs 14, verse 4, where no oxen are, the trough is clean, but much increase comes by the strength of an ox. So to just start off things, So to start things off, if you have been saved for a long period, or maybe even just got saved this morning, I think you would have recognized that Christianity is work. If you have not noticed that yet, then you are still to notice. So Christianity is work. Prayer, giving, serving, that's work. That's work from our side. So now to start off now, an ox is a castrated adult male. And it's usually kept for work. So a trough is a long and narrow container with no lid, usually used to hold water and food. So just keep that in mind. So my first point is the ox close-up. So as I already said, an ox is separated for work by the castration process so that it's only to work, to plow. You read in the Bible, you will never really hear or read anything like, Noah used the what, a cow to plow whatsoever. No, it's oxen that do the plowing if you read the Bible. So this is to set it apart for work. So now, if that is the case, then maybe that means that you and I as believers are oxen. How? Ephesians 2 verse 10 says, for we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus for good works which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. So we have been set apart for works by the Lord Most High. You can read 1 Corinthians 6 verse 11, and such were some of you, but you were washed, you were sanctified, but you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our Lord. So sanctification is synonymous with consecration, being set apart. You stand there. You're not part of this. That's us. The Lord has set us apart for his work and for his purposes. And isn't that an advantage? It's a privilege. There's just one problem. It's work. It's work from our side. John 9 verse 4 says, Jesus is saying, I must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. The night is coming when no one can work. So Jesus already set the pace. He was put on this earth to work the works of the Lord. So the second point now would be, who saw the trough? Now with the text saying, where no oxen are, the trough is clean. Meaning, the opposite now. Where oxen are, the trough is dirty. Okay? And if that is the case, it's the same with us here. To be born again, I like the way, one time we were street preaching in Auntie Nadia, she was busy street preaching, and she said, being born again is to be forgiven, it's not to be perfect. So what that basically means is, yes, you are born again, but you are still human. You are fallible. Only God is perfect. So Christianity is not an escape from problems. It means more problems, but you don't face them alone. So John 15, if you read John 15, verse 18 to 19, I won't read it. But the whole premise of the text is that the world hates us who follow the Lord Jesus. Okay? Just like my brothers were, Benji Pa was preaching on inheritance. It is not worth selling your inheritance for a world that's perishing. So John 16, verse 33 says that Jesus has overcome this world. So we can put our trust and our faith in him because he's above all and he has won it all. When he died and rose again. So we can put our trust in him. 1 John 4 verse 4 says that Jesus is greater. He who is in us is greater than he who is of this world. So that's what the text is saying. So with our flaws, God does not write us off. If you read Psalm 86 verse 15, it says that God is compassionate and gracious. If you read Psalm 78 verse 38 to 39, he remembers that we are flesh. Okay. So that now does not give us a license to sin. Okay, Romans 6 verse 15, we do not sin because we are under grace. Grace is not for us to abuse, okay? But yet, God is still willing to work with us if we submit ourselves to him. You see, if that is the case now, then it means we need to be bearing with one another. And it's not easy. It's not easy whatsoever. Love is not easy, okay? So Galatians 6 verse 2 says, bear one another's burdens. 1 John 4 verse 7 says, love one another. But just because it's not easy does not mean we should just give up now. That's why the Lord is there now to help us. We pray, Lord, help me love this person. Help me show compassion to this person. I really don't want to, but please help me. You see, and one thing we also have to remember is that, you know, it's not my church. It's not your church. It's not the pastor's church. It's the Lord's church. We just have the privilege to be a part of it. Okay. My days, I didn't realize I was that fast. Okay, never mind. So, my last point now is the Lord of the harvest. So, if you've noticed in the text, it says, where no oxen are, the trough is clean, but much increase comes by the strength of an ox. If you are really noticing or really paying attention, you notice that it's something is missing there. What about that in-between part? Where's that process? Where is it? How do you jump from where no oxen are, the trough is clean, but much increase comes from the strength of an ox? Something is missing there. Does not make sense. Well, I think what I understood now by it saying, where no oxen are, the trough is clean, but much increase comes by the strength of an ox. Meaning, God actually sees ahead of us. Okay? So, we can only see here, but God has the eagle's eye view. He sees where we are going. He knows how it's all going to end up. Another thing is that God brings the increase. It's not the strength of the ox that brings the increase. It's God. Same with us. We are not the ones who make it happen. God makes it happen through us. Okay. So the Bible says that the strength is his and that God works his plans through surrendered hearts. Let me just turn there quickly. In 2 Corinthians chapter 12, let me go from 7. The Bible says, and lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations, a thorn in the flesh was given to me, a messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I be exalted above measure. Concerning this thing, I pleaded with the Lord 3 times that it might depart from me, and he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. What that tells me is that perhaps our weaknesses are there to put us under subjection to God so that we depend on him for everything. Okay. If we did not depend on God for anything, we didn't even need to be born again. But that's not the case. We need the Lord Jesus, and hence our weaknesses are there to remind us that we don't hold it all together. We don't have it all together. That's why we have the Lord to show us and to direct us through it all. So the Bible says, You see, the Lord wants obedience in order to work through us. That's what Pastor Sabu was preaching about yesterday, if you're in the youth. Speaking of that, if you are between the ages of 12 to 25, please make time for the youth services this Saturday. Amen. So, In 1 Corinthians 1 verse 27 to 29, the premise of the text says that God has used the foolish things of this world to put to shame those who think they are wise. Okay. If you read 1 Corinthians 3 verse 6, I like the way, it's a simple text. Paul said, I planted, Apollos watered, but who brought the increase? It was God. That's the whole idea now that he was putting there before. In Ephesians 3 verse 20, the Bible says, to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we could ever ask or think. So it is God who does the most here. We just need to align ourselves with where he is going. Just with the theme up here. It's the same thing. So we allow God to flow through us. Okay. So if you did not get a thing this brother was saying here, at least remember these three things. Remember, number one, that we are called to God's, we are called to good works through salvation in Jesus Christ. If you have not given your life to Jesus, you get the opportunity to do it now. And you are called to good works. That's the first part. You are called to good works. The second part is serve God in spite of your weaknesses. You cannot say, until I'm this, and that will never come. You start now, where you are. God wants to use you where you are. The third thing is, his plans are made manifest through surrendered hearts. We don't have to look far. We can look in the Bible. Let's look at Moses. He had a stuttering issue. But this was the same man that God used to lead the Israelites out of bondage. You can look at John. John and his brother were referred to as sons of thunder. And studies have proven that actually this guy had anger issues. But God still used this man to write the book of love. Imagine. Just imagine. And Samson, although he had fallen and he had lost his eyes, the man repented. And God used him to give a harsh blow to the Philistines. The Bible says he killed more when he died than when he lived. This is the Bible. How much more you and us? You give your life to Jesus and just allow him to flow through you. Amen. So I thought that's all I have. Let's give God praise and bow our heads and close our eyes. Amen. Thank you. Hallelujah. So we get now into a very important part of the service. And this is the part for you, if you are not right with God, to make your heart right with God. Amen. You see, the Bible says that tomorrow is not promised to anybody. You can be sitting here, but you know in your heart of hearts that you are not right with God. Do not delay. You do not know what's going to happen a few minutes from now. See, the Bible says that, you know, we are separated. Our sin has separated us from God, it says in Isaiah. And religion and the law cannot suffice, cannot save you. That's where Jesus comes in. Jesus, he came, the Son of God, he came. He showed us the way, because he is the way. He died on the cross. He took all of our sins upon himself. He rose again on the third day, defeating death, and ascended into heaven, where he is seated at the right hand of the Lord. The Lord loves you, and the Bible says that he does not desire that anybody should perish, but that they should have eternal life. He wants to spend eternity with you. He has already done his part. It is now your part to do. Perhaps you are a backslider. You know these things. You left. But you can still come back while you are sitting here with your heart beating. We do not have much time, beloved. Jesus Christ is coming. There are many events, many things are happening. You can speak of the war in Israel, the turmoil that's happening worldwide in the economy. All of these are signs of the end times. An indication that the Lord is coming back. Amen. So if you are in this place and you would like to get your heart right with the Lord, please raise your hand. This is not to shame you. This is just you saying that you want to surrender your heart to the Lord. Amen. Thank you. I see those hands. Amen. Amen. Don't hold back. If you know you are not right with God, Don't let this chance slip you by. You might not get it back again. The Bible says when you hear that today is the day of your salvation. The day you hear the gospel is the day that you ought to be saved. So just raise your hands and join these honest hearts that have already raised their hands. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, those gentlemen who have raised their hands, you guys can come to the front. Amen. Amen. I'd like to have our brothers to come and pray with these young men. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Yes, my brother. Amen. So just lead them in a sinner's prayer. Amen. So, beloved, with all the three messages that have been preached, exposing the devil, don't sell your inheritance in the messy harvest, I believe that the Lord has spoken to you from one of these three sermons, or maybe in all three. So let us rise and come speak with God on these altars. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Bless you, Lord God. Oh God, you are worthy in this place, my Lord God. Oh, rendele beshandala basoko dovosa. Oh God, you are worthy, God, in this house, Lord Jesus. Bless you, Lord God, for your faithful God, your mighty. Oh God, in the name of Jesus, God, we surrender, Lord, our hearts, Lord, to your greater purposes and plans in this place, Lord Jesus. Let you flow through our hearts, Lord God, by the power of your Holy Spirit, Lord God, who is not by power nor by might, but by your Spirit. We thank you, Lord, that we get to be a part, Lord Jesus, of what you are doing in this place, God. You are mighty, Lord God. You are worthy. In Jesus'
Father
name we pray.
In heaven,
oh, thank you, Jesus.
We love you.
Oh, no, no.
We lift your name in all the earth. May your kingdom be established in our praises. As your people declare your mighty worth.
Father in heaven.
Father in heaven, how we love you. We lift your name in all the earth. May your kingdom be established in our praises. As your people declare your mighty works. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who reigns forever.
In heaven and earth.
Father in heaven, how we love you.
If you're finished praying, you can go to your seat.
We lift
sing
your
this
name
song with us.
In all the earth. May your kingdom be established in our praises. As your people declare your mighty word. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is.
Amen. Exposing the devil, don't sell your inheritance, a messy harvest. I believe the Lord has spoken. I personally have been encouraged. And I thank you all for being easy. So, amen. So, let's continue serving the Lord, encouraging one another. And, amen, that's all I have. Let's welcome Pastor as he comes.
Praise be to God. So we do appreciate this young man for the ministry, and take to heart what God has spoken to you, and work with that, and your life will never be the same again. And so every time you come to church, your aim must be, I don't want to live the same way I have come, because you know Jesus is at work. Can you say amen? He's at work. And he's always going to be at work. And he's at work in here. And he will never stop. The power in hell can stop him. And nothing can stop you and I. So we believe in God. Amen. Come on Wednesday. We're going to have a great time. Amen. In the word of the Lord. And I challenge men for morning prayer. So don't be a man who sleeps. Be a man who say, hey, I'm going to sacrifice some of my time. And as I said this morning, nothing you are going to actually miss out. Your life will only become better the more you pray. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. So, Jesus loves you, friend. I love you, all of you too. We're going to dismiss the word of prayer. And if you're live streaming and want to give your life to Jesus, please send, call the number that is provided up there. And then there should also be some instruction on how to do that. And we will gladly lead you to Christ. All right. So, heads bowed, eyes are closed as we pray. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for your power, your presence. No one, Jesus, can be compared to you. And I ask you in Jesus' name, may the grace of God rest upon your people, dear God. Bless them as they go out. In Jesus' name, we thank you. Amen. God dismiss. God bless you.